it's over here. Thank you, Doug. Welcome back to our Monday evening lecture series. We will continue the Monday evening version in 2 weeks on March 15th with Peter Hales, Professor and Chair of Art History here at UIC. Tomorrow night we have a special Tuesday night version of our otherwise Monday usual lecture series, which is sometimes Wednesday, unless it has to be Friday or Thursday. But tomorrow's special installment, tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, Witte of MBRDB will be here. So tell your friends who otherwise won't know. Or actually don't tell them so you can get a seat. So keep it a secret. Now that you're here, you know a secret. So we look forward to Witte tomorrow night. I'm especially happy to be able to introduce Ron Witte this evening, who is our spring Greenwald visiting critic. He's just beginning a four-day workshop with the second-year grads, and that review of that work will take place on Thursday afternoon. So stop by and see what he's cooked up for second years on Thursday. Ron is a displaced Beach Boy surfer, originating initially from San Diego. He received his first professional degree from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, and then shifted coast to the Jersey Shore, where he received his MR from Princeton, and currently is now on yet another coast as the an associate professor at Rice in Houston. Like Witte Maas, Ron is also a graduate alumni of ONA in Rotterdam. I'm not sure if there was much surfing there or if it was any good, but I suspect not. Ron, beyond teaching now at Rice, has previously taught at University of Florida Gainesville, University of Kentucky, Harvard, and most recently before Rice at Princeton for a number of years. He was also the editor of a monograph on Toyo Ito's Media Tech, among many other publications and essays. In 1999, Ron co-founded the firm WW with his partner Sarah Whiting. I should say that tonight Sarah is lecturing at IIT, which gives you some sense of their opportunism, or at least their perverse sense of humor. appropriate that Sarah is at IIT and Ron is here. The office in general, clearly through a signature of projects that you can see before you in this preview, sneak preview, deals with many issues, but among them the issue of I think what they, Ron and Sarah both referred to as the 2.5D. Sarah's historical work on that issue, you could say, takes Mises IIT campus as one version of that 2.5D, which she calls a bas-relief urbanism. Ron's own work is developed through the idea of the figure. And so I suppose it's appropriate that Sarah's down there in the bastion of the history and the legacy of modernism and that bas-relief field, and that Ron is really here with us tonight in the bastion of postmodern field theory. If IIT is to the city's modernist legacy, UIC is to the city's postmodernist legacy. And I think that Ron, you know, more than almost anyone in his generation has contributed, and this may have something to do with the, you can straighten all this out afterwards, the Graves legacy at Princeton, that there is an implicit recuperation of the idea of the postmodern figure in WW's work. And I think that this place in particular, with our legacy of postmodernism, would be an interesting place to rethink the problem of the figure today. It's really, I would say, Ron's signal contribution, both in his design and his writing, is to rethink the form, program, dyad, if you will, and precisely to think it through the issue of the figure. And you could say, rather than opposing form and function, that Ron's interest in program is necessarily connected historically to a revisitation of the issue of figure. And you can see that through many of WW's competition-winning projects or the San Jose State Museum, Art Museum, the St. Francis School, the Inter Center in Lexington, Kentucky, and on and on. Clearly, this revisiting of a postmodern figure, but in a kind of contemporary guise, in other words, eschewing any meaning associated with the figure through conventional association or resemblance. Ron really exposes, you could say, the abstract nature of the figure, or the potential abstraction of the figure, and that has been a history really repressed within the regime of high modernist formalism. So that if there is a generation now revisiting mannerist geometries and certain kinds of digital intricacy, that Ron's work is really meant to extend a different potential history. And that particularly the idea of the figure that can combine performance on the one hand, along with communication. And I think it's Ron who has launched the unseemly project, you could say, the figure, and even of postmodernism's underbelly. But it's a kind of conversation that has happened really much in a larger sense with the work of Alejandro Zarapola, Jeffrey Kipnis, and many others who are now taking on the issue of figuration in the postmodern again. And so it is with great pleasure that we welcome the figural half of WW, Ron Witte.
Go on the left, and another diagram that was produced by Kepish in the early 60s. Kepish was a sort of visual theorist, might be a big word for it, but a visual culture person of the early 60s teaching MIT. The difference between these two diagrams, in my view, what's interesting about them in the case is that there's a binary setup in the game of Go, meaning black is black and white is white. The objective of the game is for either black or white to capture zones, including the other, and thereby win points. So, in fact, the objective or conclusion of the game is to maintain that distinctive binary. The difference in this diagram is that every one of the ping pong balls is painted black and white, and in fact, they see their local status, meaning this being black or this being white, to a composite set of relationships in which the cluster of white becomes more important, the cluster of black becomes more important, a series of serial migrations become more important. And there's a kind of compounding, that term is something that'll happen probably frequently tonight. But there's a kind of compounding in the relationships among black and white. This again, the same diagram now with our overlay on top of it to try to give you some sense of what I mean. Some of this is coming through in the setup for the workshop that I introduced this afternoon, meaning that to a certain extent this also produces an odd phenomenon, which is that at any point, and at many places in this case in the grid, there are locations where you're in two rooms at the same time, for example, and that's in large part what underlies the workshop that we're doing this week. In any case, I think that this is a large departure from the idea of figure as a singular, figure as a kind of gravitational certainty in various ways, whether formal or otherwise, to have an understanding of this compound as opposed to binary. Now, basically, this is a giant game of Twister. The way that I'm imagining the organization of space, and just to give you some idea of how figures begin to entangle one another. Of course, there's the collective Twister. There's also the Mini 68 Twister, and that's sort of the underpinning for the talk tonight. The first project that I want to show fairly briefly is quite old at this point. It's the Intercenter, and the reason is I think some of the things that we've been working on in our practice hover around issues that date back to this project in different ways, and will cycle through in a lot of different iterations and different projects. So I'll try to do this in a fairly rapid way because it may be familiar to many of you. The project is about a 40,000 square foot community center located in Lexington, Kentucky. We were approached by the principal of an elementary school here and a nonprofit organization working in partnership to respond to some issues that they saw in the neighborhood. The neighborhood is about two-thirds living below the poverty line. So the aim of this program in the new building was to basically supply all of the amenities that people didn't have within their own domestic circumstances. Which was a lot. And so when we sat down with this pair of people, a pair of organizations in a sense, the first thing that was striking to us was the absolute strangeness of the list of program that they handed us. And what was kind of shocking was we, as Bob mentioned, we had been working at OMA, and we had been schooled at a moment when the hybrid project was extremely important. It was the kind of hot button issue for a lot of our formations in the late 80s and early 90s, I'd say. And here we were sitting across from two women who, in fact, were far more sophisticated as hybridists than we were. And so basically, they took the wind out of our sails, and we were trying to figure out, well, what the hell were we with that? We could no longer make a play, it seemed like, within that. And at this point, we started to realize that, in fact, what we were witnessing was the hybrid project having become mature. It was no longer sufficient to simply mix, but we had to figure out what that meant to us as architects, or how to mix. Or to some extent, we began to toy with the idea of what the conclusion of those mixings might be. So our response at this point was to look at a very simple notion coming from a model of functionalism that was the idea that program and form are concentric in a functionalist model. You can go through a series of migrations in different ways in which program and form, you can take red and black either way, program and form begin to slide off of one another and have a semi-concentric concentric or a non-concentric relationship. In this project, what we did essentially was, because of the size of the program, we maxed out the site, we poured the program into it, we imposed a series of organizing surfaces inside the program that were cross-grained with that program, diagrammatically looking something like that. I'll explain those surfaces and the program in just a moment. Now, the idea for us in this project was to look at the set of surfaces in this building as what we term a set of parentheses. And they work a lot like parentheses. You can imagine that this bracket might join with this bracket, or this bracket, or this wall, or this bracket, etc. And similarly, this one might join with this one, or this one, or this one. And you get a kind of a resonating, oscillating sense of one space adapting to another space, or a sequence of spaces, particularly if you imagine an on-field relationship. There's a service corridor that runs along these. I'll show you the plans in a moment. You can imagine a series of oscillating relationships that are clustered, nested, parallel, superimposed on top of one another throughout the building. So this was a kind of underpinning for the organization of the building for us, producing plans that look like this. First, second, third, fourth. It's a terrible layout for the plan, sorry about that. Don't pay attention to this one. Ground floor plan, almost entirely open. On the third floor, hallway in which the figure of the hallway creates this overlap with the program areas, meaning these are now part hallway to part program, to create a kind of vestibule or anti-space before one goes into another space, where there's a kind of super figure imposed upon the smaller figures of individual program cells. Sometimes program floated out into or inserted into larger program regions over the children's play area on the lower level at the bottom floor, at times not allowing views all the way down to the pool. A series of figures that cross-link and cross-fertilize and sort of reverberate through the building. One of the things that grew out of this for us was an awareness of, as Bob pointed out, the degree to which we were stepping in the pool of the 80s, meaning the kind of figural discourse of the 80s, which had an enormous amount to do with the postmodern discourse of that moment, and in fact, in particular, the architectural version of it, which had to do with a particular architectural idiom. Now, what we began to work with relative to that in this project was the idea that the figure at one time produces legibility. That was important to us because it's a way of engaging the public and producing a relationship to a broader constituency. That was a kind of good side of the debate, let's say. And at the same time, it also produces degrees of enclosure and distinction that we were somewhat concerned about here because this was supposed to be everybody's living room or a kind of transparent institution. So we began to work with the idea that the degree of figuration in the building was greater at the top and lesser at the bottom. Kind of free plan at the bottom that became more and more figured as you go up into the building. That's what this diagram is about explaining. So that as you come into the building laterally at the base of it, you basically move into it and you understand those figures from the bottom up as opposed to from their sides. The next project that I want to talk about is a competition that we entered not too long ago. It's a very strange competition for us because I looked at the brief for this for a long time, for several months, and I didn't want to do the competition. It was for a sound barrier for a runway, a secondary remote runway at Schiphol Airport outside Amsterdam. And I kept looking at this thing thinking, why would we do this? Why would we do a sound barrier? We know nothing about sound barriers. It seems to me there's no place for figuring a sound barrier. And we looked at it, and I kept seeing this sort of asterisk in the brief that mentions 2 million square feet of program. And then I put it down and say, oh, yeah, but it's just a sound barrier. And I kept seeing this asterisk. And I kept thinking, well, let's not do it. And I kept thinking, maybe we should have 2 million square feet. That's kind of interesting. So what was compelling about it ultimately was the idea that 2 million square feet is exactly the same, holds exactly the same population as the population of Schiphol Airport on any given day. And so what we were able, and interestingly enough, was also the population of a nearby village that was in fact requesting protection from the sound along this runway. So what we were suddenly confronted with was the possibility that we could be doing a third city in the area. The first city being the airport, the second city being the village, and the third city being 2 million square feet of program that was speculative, sort of R&D park type program. So we did decide to do the competition, and our aim in the competition was to expand our use of the figure and certain kinds of geometric logics and their control, or their sort of disciplining, let's say, of program and landscape and infrastructure in a way that would never allow particular subunits, say, program or terrace or bike paths or a parking garage or an inclined landscape with sound barriers on it, never allow any one of those to be extricated without damaging the others. And here there's an idea which is something that I mentioned today during a workshop, which is the idea that geometry in itself is a kind of a completely evacuated condition. And that what happens when we put it into play in a system like this is that geometry produces explicit and implicit sets of relations among different subthreads of architecture and urbanism in this case. And that means that geometry is not necessarily controlling program, not necessarily controlling technology, but is in fact establishing the ability of program to jump, to become an outdoor space, to jump, to become a parking access zone, to jump, to become a bike path, and the organization of a park and acoustic barrier out in the landscape. So geometry here is used to constantly generalize and produce a kind of synthetic relationship among lots and lots of subthreads in architecture. That has to do, or that is a kind of means for us to pursue generalism as a platform for our approach to architecture and urbanism, as opposed to understanding what we do as a kind of expertise or an expertise in a particular subdomain. We're interested in developing our expertise as generalists, let's say. The subcomponents that I'm talking about are self-evident here. You can read that roads, paths, etc. But you can see the way these subcomponents are then overlaid, the ones that may not be legible here, the bottom text of the buildings here, parking garage here, and about 15,000 sound barrier baffles in the bottom image on the right. Those are overlaid to produce a diagram like this, or a kind of quasi-diagram, quasi-architecture. One of the other things that's increasingly important to us as architects is the idea that the way that we work in terms of working methods uses means, uses diagrams, uses instruments that are in fact themselves already close to being architecture and aren't necessarily removed from the production of architecture in a direct way. This for us is it's a response to our own formation. I remember sitting in seminars in graduate school in the Northeast, it starts with P, where we were constantly told never, never, never instrumentalize theory. And I think over the course of the years that followed, we've done a complete about face on that. And my suggestion would be always, 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 always instrumentalize theory. And so this is a kind of reflection of that logic. A larger view of this, you can start to see that what those paths do, how they interact. Obviously very schematic, very diagrammatic, but you get some sense of this. This is a very large inclined plane with these 15,000 barriers on it. Two of the fields, because it's all the green parts are the program areas, the dark green parts are the program areas, the groups of buildings, outdoor terraces. This is a parking garage that strings along the entire length of the incline. The sound barrier is actually produced or developed by inclining the surface and then placing these big clamshell-shaped, scoop-shaped objects on the field aimed at the intense parts of the airplane takeoff cycle. Just some images of the organization of the space in section. Here you can see the project that won. They didn't think there were 2 million square feet, I think. We were thrown out right away. In any case, what was interesting to us was the idea that
that this could in fact be an elaboration of this, and it was a kind of our premise about generalism or integration, arguably on steroids, but at any time it'd be interesting to see what it was. The next project that I want to talk about is what do you think it's called? X House. And this is a project that we were commissioned to do by a couple in Massachusetts. The site there, the couple lives in Boston, they have two kids. The site's in Western Massachusetts. And they wanted to build a weekend house out on what's almost the perfect site. Perfect site in particular for something like a second year studio project. It's got a meadow, it's got a hill, it's got some woods, it's got a creek, it's got an old building, it's got everything you'd want to sort of lay out the perfect studio project circa 1982. And what we were curious about in this was how idyllic it was, and in fact how absolutely remote it was from all other forms of housing, and the fact that that might actually play into a particular lineage, which is the lineage of the villa a la Palladio. And we began to look at that villa like this. This does not mean Palladio is bad. This means that we were interested in the idea that when you take a cross plan like this and simply rotate the arms, a very particular set of things ensue from that. If you look at the existing villa, there's this round space in the middle, which is only visible here right now. But in any case, there's a round space in the middle, which is captured and without really meaning to criticize Palladio, because he's an okay guy. It's kind of a dead space in the middle. It's cut off by the programmatic blocks and the circulation tunnels on either side. It's cut off by density of the block in the middle. But simply by rotating this and adding to it the fact of contemporary construction, etc., what we produced is instead of a dead zone in the middle, we produced a repulsive space in the middle. By which I mean a space in which it's very difficult to stay here without being pulled out into the wings of the house or through the house itself as a kind of tunnel. And that simple act was something that we became very curious about in the evolution of a cruciform plan. A couple of other things ensue from it. One is the difference between these sides, side yard, side gardens, and the broad gardens in front and back. In this case, the house can nestle up against a grove of trees here and open out onto a meadow on this side. These becoming ways of clipping into a very expansive external landscape, whereas these small units are folded into almost internalized gardens off of a family room and master bedroom and off of an outdoor dining space in the living room over here. Sort of diagram through the process. This is that crossing where you can see the tunnel going through the house here, front to back, so the entry to the house here, and a structural system which is meant to load the center crossing structurally, but at the same time keep it evacuated through a series of semi-arches, posts that turn into arches on the other side that were framing this view all the way through. You also get a sense of how then those structural frames are threaded back into circulation and program to produce a kind of synthetic relationship one to the next. I'll come back to this topic a little later, but one of the things that we've tried to invest increasing amounts of energy in our practice is the idea that while technology I mean here, old school structures, mechanical systems, et cetera, not digital, while technology is obviously extraordinarily important, we're not at all interested in showing our hardware on that front. And so here there's a kind of integration of the structural system and the programmatic system, say. One of the effects of this is to do some odd things with perspective as well. In this case, you're seeing from a position in the living room, you're seeing an odd view down the hallway toward the family room and still to the outside. This is I can maybe best equate it with the way that a flounder, when it sits on the ocean floor, has eyes on the same side of its body, two eyes on the same side of its body. It's a strange kind of cross-eyed view through the space looking out. There's a minor inflection in the roof of the building as well.
much more secondary to the plan cruciform work that you're doing, which had to do with this bump, this tunnel, and this bump here. The house is very modest, and we pushed the roof up just slightly to make it a little bit more generous space in the living room. This is the loop that goes around the tunnel and the entry, and it ultimately forms that structural system around the entryway. And this is a bump over a closet. Rather than adding an additional bedroom into the house, so that the kids could have friends over, we built a closet, or designed a closet, house wasn't built. We designed a closet between two bedrooms that became a sleeping loft with a kind of lump in the roof that you could sleep under when guests were there. Very quickly, the program, family room, master bedroom, master bath, bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, living room, and an outdoor eating area, parking area over here, walkway going up, and tunnel back to the woods here. Next project that I want to show is one that Bob referred to in the introduction. This is a project for San Jose State University as a Museum of Art Design. We won a competition very similar in scale to the Inter Center, about 40,000 square feet, now about 42. On a very heavily trafficked part of the campus, this is the most heavily trafficked walkway at the campus of San Jose State University. We did this, actually, we were shortlisted along with Bob. This competition was a very interesting moment, I think, in our work, and I think it was very interesting to watch what Bob produced as well, a really important building, in fact. But what was interesting to us about this competition was the same old nemesis figures for us in terms of the way we were trying to articulate what we want to do with the museum. Indeterminacy and determinacy, let's say, as the two poles. What was curious to us about this competition was the way in which the organizers said to us that on the one hand, they had no idea what sort of art would go into this facility. It's a Kunsthalle, not a collecting museum, so it's all traveling art. And it's also a teaching institution, which means that the degree of speculation is up a notch as well. And essentially, it's impossible to qualify what art is today, even in known museums like MoMA, et cetera. And so on one hand, we were told we have no idea what's going to go into this. And on the other, we were told we need to have an absolutely strong identity. And those two mission statements for us were sort of on a collision course. Anybody who had been at least partially schooled in modernism would wonder how you could identify architecture, how you could build a strong identity if you didn't know what was supposed to happen inside it. And so this was a kind of interesting moment for us as well, that we began to look at the kind of slipped relationship of a building's identity to its use. The way we began to work on this was through a system of, and you've heard me refer to this in the workshop today, a system of regulated lines that course through the building, first floor, second floor, third floor, fourth. And in particular, we began to look at where it made sense to be more figurally particular within the makeup of an organization like this. And what we began to realize was that the larger spaces sort of gravitate toward genericness, and that smaller spaces could in fact provoke the possibility of identifiable states. So we started to look at secondary spaces like the place where you find the wall text as you walk into a gallery in the second floor plan right here, or a coat check area on the first floor, or a place where the building connects into the third floor, the new building connects into the existing building on the third floor, or a series of light wells that come down to the fourth floor in the administrative area. So these secondary spaces became for us programmatic endings that warranted being more figured, more legible, and the rest of the spaces, gallery here, or auditorium space, open space overlooking the gallery, were sort of left to go into a more mute state. This produced a diagram that looked like this in an early stage, and I'm going to come back to this also to show you a certain evolution in it, but a diagram in which you can begin to see clusters of relationships across the first, second, third, and fourth floors, one here, one here, one here, those clusters have to do with things like structural alignments, stair alignments, egress alignments, HVAC systems, et cetera, hallway circulation, and they start to come through in the plans. This is an early stage diagram. One of the other things that, I don't know if I mentioned that today or not in the workshop, but one of the other things that we began to do here was refer to these regulating systems as Darwinian, meaning they're not frozen, they're not idealized, there's not a kind of 3-4 geometry or that funny escargot thing that we all learned about in our second week of architecture school. There's, in fact, an organization, a system of geometric organization, which from day one is in motion and in fact remains in motion through the evolution of the project, gripping certainly organization, certainly form, circulation, technology, but also gripping to a certain extent economies, site relationships, and other kinds of things into its grasp. Just a diagram or plan of the first floor and the set of issues that we were primarily looking at, the geometry, the secondary program, those programmatic eddies, gallery spaces, circulation, structure, and the primary plan on the ground floor coming through an entry here, a breezeway here, auditorium here, a cafe down here, a gallery here, and another gallery here. Same plan here, black and white, second floor gallery space. There's that figure on those that I was talking about, gallery spaces here, breezeway coming through on the ground floor here. On the third floor, the terrace that attaches to the roof of the outdoor space here, a connection to the existing building, more galleries here, some teaching spaces and administrative areas for the most part of the fourth floor. So if you're looking up in the lobby section, with a gallery, auditorium, breezeway, cafe. This is an outdoor space at the cafe. One of the other things that was of interest to us in this project was the way in which non-Cartesian geometries begin to engage Cartesian geometries. And so on the one hand, there are circumstances like this, eventually being, this project is sort of deep freeze, I'd say at this point, given the economy. But we went as far as developing a corrugated glass panel system for the walls. So these corrugated glass surfaces would come in at various points would be very free of the Cartesian geometry, and at other points be brought entirely into line with the Cartesian geometry, like this, where there's a glass impregnated concrete, which is in fact a kind of shimmering concrete, and a very dense, very heavy version of glass, which brings the two into a kind of material collusion, but also geometric collusion. Now, as I mentioned, this diagram went through an evolution, and what was interesting to us later on in the development of the project was the role of the continuous line. The reason that I wanted to talk about this tonight was already today several times I've referred to my issues with the continuous surface project, which I think is a very interesting topic for debate right now in constructive ways. But I think that what we were struck by during the course of the development of this project was the idea that those continuous lines that we were calling Darwinian regulating lines were increasingly cumbersome when it came to organizing things that had dimensional thickness. So a structural column, a mechanical chase, a stairway, that everything in architecture is ultimately made of some dimensional strait, a trait, and is in fact obliged to acknowledge that thickness in some way. We began to look at how we could incorporate thickness into our diagram, and while we kept kind of a trace of the continuous line, we began to look at offsets and sort of remote echoes of that line as a way of starting to incorporate those thicknesses. What was interesting, it was a bit hard to get our heads around this because the sort of notion of the continuous was so embedded in thinking at that time and I think in many ways it still is. What was interesting to us was the idea that segments and echoes and offsets, etc., were a much more idealized form of organization or enabled us to be much more idealized than the continuous line. And that was a kind of strange thing to get our heads around, but I continue to think that that's a truism, and I think that that's extraordinarily interesting, that broken things are more effective or more optimal than continuous things. And in later iterations, we began to exploit the development of the scheme through what we came to term subsets, sets, and supersets, meaning interactions among different surface types, floor, the green, ceiling, the blue, and furniture pieces in the landscape, the yellow, as well as ultimately plantings that are shown in this plan. But we began to look at the interaction of those different surfaces, which is, for me, the origin of the essay that I had out of the workshop, which is the Go Figure essay, and in particular, the topic of alignment in that essay, how those various surfaces constitute through their alignments, through alignments like floors becoming ceilings, becoming floors again, becoming benches, etc., as you move through the building. Those alignments are in fact producing a set of figures which are kind of larger aggregations of smaller units of organization. Just the ground, just the ceiling, and then diagrams of those sets, supersets kinds of issues. A set, for example, of the surface, the ceiling surface perched over an outdoor entry and the stair at the corner, a subset surface and ceiling, which a small part of the auditorium is clipped out for smaller auditorium gatherings. Another set in which the use of a partial area of the stage could be expanded out to the outdoor space for evening events outside in an outdoor courtyard. Other versions of that, a superset made up of very smaller components. The next project is a tower. We were approached by a developer to design a tower in Ho Chi Minh City. And there were a lot of striking things about this. One was the idea of a tower in a city in which the urbanism basically looks like this. And at the same time, you have things like this happening. So we were asked to somehow contend with that kind of context and that sort of progress. So a couple things were curious to us in this. One, we returned to the idea that the floor plate is neither something that's interesting to pursue as a completely free plan, nor is it interesting to pursue as an entirely determined state. In this case, all of the yellow zones are fixed zones of programmatic things like conference rooms, garden spaces, terraces, meeting areas, specialized offices, etc. And the white areas are kind of free plan, open to whatever might come their way version of plate planning. So what we did was develop the building in which these diagrams you can see on the bottoms of the plans indicate a series of linkages produced through yellow-to-yellow relationships, walkways, and sort of specialized programming that make their way up in the building, in a sense providing an urbanism inside the building that's a lot like the urbanism of the city outside at a lower level. Section through that building, which we started to exploit, actually passage up through. One of the other things that's curious about social and economic development in this context is the quite woolly nature of it in Ho Chi Minh City, meaning there are moments in which large aggregations of people are required in very large spaces, and other times when very small, meaning one person, two people, three people, require spaces that are suited to that scale. So we wanted to produce a building in which you could imagine aggregations taking over a zone like that, or simply taking over a zone like that, or like that, at various kinds of scales. We were also curious in this case about what the relationship between structural technology and that programmatic organization might be. And we started to look at a series of offset trusses in which each plate, or rotating trusses like a house of cards, each plate would only have one structural line running through its and across its surface, which is what these diagrams are showing. And they stack up to produce a kind of stable crate of relationships all the way up. The next project is a house that we're just finishing in Princeton, New Jersey. It is a house that we were approached by the owners before they purchased the property. They came to us and they said, well, would you take a look at this property? And tell us if you think we should buy it. And so we said, okay, we went over and looked at it. And because we really, really wanted commission.
we said, yeah, you should buy it if you're willing to turn down two-thirds of it. Actually, that's not true. We said we should turn down two-thirds of it because there were two wings in this house. We did want the permission. There are two wings in this house, an older wing back on this side and a newer wing over here. This is basically 20th century, and this is 18th, later 18th, and earlier mid-19th century back in here. And this has been added on and was an extraordinarily bad addition. So what we had proposed to them was that they keep this, which is quite beautiful, although really primitive, kind of American agrarian building, single cell, about 6 foot three high at the ceiling. Single cell of space here. And so we told them to keep this, get rid of this, and they ended up buying the property and hiring us to deal with the replacement of that space or the development of a new wing. Our approach to this was to try to come to terms with two paradigms really in architecture. One of them is a modern approach to this, which would mean to say, well, why don't we just tear down the whole thing? And in fact, it would be far easier to do that, meeting this factor as well. Not that interesting a building, but it has a certain kind of character to it. Versus, say, a more recent sensibility in which everything old is supposed to be saved, and no matter how good or bad it is. And we thought those were sort of ridiculous filters at the extremes of destroy or keep logic. So what we decided to do was to concentrate not on the new or the old, but to develop a kind of joint piece, a hinge piece in the middle of the house, which is this surface at the entrance to the new, now reconfigured house, is a kind of a box. It's a box whose it's entirely made of teak, made out of wood, and it's a box that, as you run through it this way, is completely transparent. It's open here and open here, and through the development of the design, unwinds into the house to produce a stairway that winds up to the second floor from the first floor to produce an overhead ceiling in the dining area here, family dining room, to produce a kind of frame across the front of the sunroom over here to line the entryway itself, produce a kind of linkage back into the old house on a corridor floor, etc. So this house is a giant octopus of wood that goes out and connects the two and becomes it becomes the kind of legible status of the house in most respects, and was the thing that we were primarily focused on. Turns into casework, floors, ceilings. Here you can see that on the first floor, there's a sunroom here, kitchen here, dining room here, family dining room, there's another formal dining room here, the entryway, formal entrance here, through a large plate glass window here, looking north. Stairway that is an unfilled version of that box going up to the second floor. In the second floor, you can see that surface skating across the roof of the second floor, connecting to the roof of the terrace here, coming across, I'll show you an image of this in a moment, coming across the ceiling down the master bedroom door. This is the master bedroom, master closet, master bathroom, study here, kids playroom here, bedroom. These are the old parts of the house. But you can sort of see this surface unwinding, going down the door, going across the floor here, coming up the stairs, going across the ceiling, and winding down the door here. There's the front of that house showing the extent of that surface through. There's the house still under construction. So that box lines up at this point. There you can see a little bit more before the teak goes up. The ceiling of the box here going through a window at the back of the master bedroom. You can see those two skylight oculi back in the distance there. There's a James Bond TV that comes out of the octopus skin there. Here's a view up to see, these are still construction photos, but the lining of that box and coming over to wrap the master bedroom door here, coming up the stair, wrapping around the kids' playroom here. A very basic diagram. I thought this was an interesting image. There was a, this is a totally quoted point. I thought it was quite interesting. I saw a reference to a conversation between or among Moshe Mostafavi, Bernard Chumi, and Michael Hayes with GSD. There was a reference that Bernard Chumi made to the nature of imagery today and the kinds of images that we're using to produce architecture, to think about architecture. In fact, that was his point, thinking part. But he was discussing the nature of rendered imagery today and the fact that it's almost
sufficient saturation, in a kind of liberal sense, the pixels on white don't have sufficient saturation to somehow convey intent, which I thought was a kind of interesting observation. This is a very old school drawing that we produced not so long ago, actually, but I was curious about that comment on his side. Here's that figure being buried by the program, first floor, second floor. One of the other things that was interesting to us, and this came up a little bit, I think, today in some of the conversations in the studio and the workshop, one of the things that was interesting to us here was the fact that the old houses, I mentioned, the existing rooms had this incredibly low height where my hair would basically rub the bottom of beams coming down. And so we didn't want to tamper with that section, but we also, in the new house, wanted to have a more generous section, a more generous ceiling height. So we were struck, we were stuck with this idea that we couldn't go too high, but we also didn't want to, as I mentioned earlier, we didn't want to display our hardware, meaning dust and beams. And so we had to come into a single plane. And what was therefore resulting was the idea that dust, this duct and this beam, for example, are existing in the same plane with almost precisely the same depth. They're within about an inch and a half of being a 12-inch depth, both of them. And so, if you think about that, that's a real no-no, that there's a hole in the beam, which is almost the depth of the entire beam. So we had to work very closely with a structural engineer to put moment frames, in essence, around this opening to enable this to work. But perhaps equally or more interestingly, was a kind of relocation of trades in the process to enable this sort of synthesis of duct alignment and wood framing, relatively simple idea, in fact, in construction. Except for the fact that this hole had to be precisely located. This duct obviously doesn't fit in any place misaligned relative to these joists. So the steel frame, the steel fabricator had to put these hangers on. Normally a responsibility that would be given to the framer, not the steel person. But in the interest of assuring the sectional condition, we actually had to kind of retool the fabrication setup there. And what that also did was began to amplify for us the value of the superficial, of the kind of thin in architecture. Not as a negative trait, but in fact as an extremely interesting condition, which for us, if we're not interested in the display of that hardware, then we become by default at on one level, but also by excitement on another level, interested in the thing that skates across the surface as opposed to the thing that somehow is deep within the surface, structure or something else. So this is a working drawing, but with an overlay of the extents of the wood teak that runs up and down the walls. Here you can see a detail, extremely simple detail, in which sheetrock is meeting wood. And rather than saying that this is a thick piece of wood, we worked hard to, in fact, let the sheetrock come out and turn the wood into a kind of coat of paint through this little piece of trim, which is a slightly modified standard piece of trim that you can order from a regular company. But the idea was to reduce the thickness of wood to the thickness of paint coming across the wall. This is the only piece of exposed steel in the house, once it's all enclosed. I think this is the last project. The last project I want to show is a project that takes off on that notion of superficiality and is about a 23,000 square foot renovation of the drama division spaces at the Juilliard School in New York. And we are the tiny version hidden within the building of the large Dillard's Cathedral project, unrelated to theirs. What was interesting here was in the conversations we were having with the client, the kinds of skirmishes that were happening relative to the most minute amounts of space. In other words, this wasn't about a new lobby or a new space or a new room or a new teaching area. This was about, can I get my file cabinet to be 30 inches deep instead of 27 inches deep? Now, it was really extraordinary. I think it's a state of Manhattan, given at least then real estate values. And so we were struck by this, that everything was happening in sort of measurements of 3 inches or sort of control tolerances of that degree. So what we began to look at, we were given responsibility for a student lounge, which you're looking at here, a set of administrative spaces, and the teaching areas, which are kind of quasi-performance spaces. So what we began to look at was how, in particular, the student lounge, we could wrap a corridor relationship back through a kind of small zone of a layer of space here, back into another layer of space here, simply by this kind of articulation of back and forth oscillations of grain through the space. Using really the surface of the floor, some furniture, and the surface of the ceiling and ceiling system, and lighting and mechanical systems to produce that set of binders. These are very early drawings. The effect being ultimately, to go back to the intracenter, which is why I wanted to talk about it, is kind of coursing through this project now again, there is a set of oscillating relationships that are circulation, programmed lighting, very public, less public, different temporal status, say during events, not events, study hours, students, parents, etc., kind of coursing through the organization of the building. Here's a plan now where you can start to see ghosted in at various intervals, vestibule treatments of the ceilings, overhead, seating, benches, different uses of organizational surfaces to connect this to this to this, these into the rooms here. Sarah worked for Eisenman, we both worked for OMA. think that we, in terms of formation, found ourselves very interested in the program, the kind of status of the program as a result of our experience at OMA. And in terms of our own interests as well, right? It's kind of we were drawn to OMA because we had an interest in that experience, reinforced that sensibility. In my view, one of the problems with, or one of the interesting things about program is that it happens on the plan. That it this is part of the argument I'm making in this Go Figure article, that program is organized as a kind of bureaucratic state and an infinitely thin surface across the plan. So for us, a lot of this does have to do with the generation of plan organizations. At the same time, the way in which one apprehends those is through a kind of verticalization program. So making formal or making legible those states through walls or through correlate relationships with floor and ceiling. But in fact, I think it's a good question. This is one of the things that we're becoming curious about, is to what extent the section gets implicated in this way in other ways. So that's something we're looking at. For example, one of the interesting, one of my interests right now is holes. And holes are by definition sectional. They're just holes. And how in fact holes project their status outside the limit of a hole. In other words, if I cut a hole here, is what I did, how this hole in fact projects its role onto the floor plate above, onto the floor plate below, in different kinds of ways. So in fact, it's still an affectation of the surface, the horizontal surface, but it's something that produces a vertical relationship.
Yeah.
Depends a bit. So it depends a bit on the project.
But I would say that we are, in part, we're not at all interested in mapping sites, for example. And so, in the case of the house, one of the things you might notice about that box is it has openings on two sides. That's a kind of a site gesture that, relative to the house, it sort of expands this way and this way, so that as you come in one opening, for one, you see an opening that registers entry, and you look right through to the outside. If you come in from the other side, or in fact, you don't go through there, you look through from the other side, you see right back to the backyard. So there's a kind of an optical transparency there, which is produced by that view. In the case of the San Jose project, the part of the argument was how we access that high-traffic pedestrian link to the north of the building, and pull people through the entry or through the breezeway on the, what you were looking at is on the left side, into the courtyard space. So the geometries tend to emanate from the organization of the building. They're not sort of mappings of site, but they eventually expand beyond the scope of the building to grip site or to produce relationships to site. So, but it's, I think we also have a predilection for what is happening internally in a building, and so we tend to begin there, not with what do we think about on the site. For example, I always thought that the student center was a kind of goofy diagram. The Kohlhaas student center was a goofy diagram, and then actually when it was built, it was very interesting to me. So the original diagram that you go out there and measure where people are seemed to be foolish at best. Ultimately, I think it's extremely interesting in terms of what it produces on the inside of the building, so I don't really care about its origins at this point. But the sort of first step in that process, we're not interested in. To an extent, although I'd say that's a cop-out on our